Hello, my name is Drew. I'm one of the engineers here at SparkFun, and one of the reasons that I got into engineering is because of my participation in a FIRST Robotics, specifically the FIRST Tech Challenge program, or FTC, where I continue to volunteer at competitions and as a mentor. One of the big topics in FTC, and really robotics in general, is a concept called odometry, basically trying to figure out where your robot is located for things like autonomous navigation. There's lots of different solutions for odometry, such as using encoders on your wheels to figure out how far you translate, proximity sensors to measure a distance to a wall, or even using a camera to find visual fiducial markers like April tags. But today, we are announcing a brand new sensor to add to your toolkit, introducing the SparkFun Qwiic Optical Tracking Odometry Sensor. The primary component on this board is an optical tracking sensor, very similar to like a mouse sensor that measures X and Y displacement with a laser. However, this is not a simple breakout board. On the other side of the board, it also includes a 6-axis inertial measurement, or IMU, which features a 3-axis accelerometer and 3-axis gyroscope. But that's not all. The biggest feature on this board is a microcontroller that takes data from both of those sensors and performs the sensor fusion to do all the tracking entirely by itself. The microcontroller also provides an I2C interface for communication to get data and configure it. Now let's see a demo of it in action. Here you can see I have an experimental robotics platform, or XRP, with one of the Qwiic optical tracking odometry sensors mounted to the chassis and connected to the control board with a Qwiic cable. That's really all the hardware I've added, just the sensor, the mount, and the cable. As for the software on here, this demo is a real simple example. It just takes the data from the optical sensor and sends it over USB to my laptop, where I have a processing script running that takes that data and draws the location of the robot as measured by the optical tracking odometry sensor. And as you can see, as I move the robot around, it is drawing the location of the robot pretty accurately on the screen. So hopefully you can see it's pretty easy to get going with the sensor, and that was really one of the main goals of this project, because a lot of other odometry solutions can be a little tricky to get working, especially if you are a younger student or new to robotics. Because all of the tracking is done by the sensor itself, you don't need any higher level math or programming skills in order to get location of your robot. And because of the small form factor, it also makes it pretty easy to add really anywhere under your robot. So the sensor is easy to use, but how about the performance? I mentioned FIRST Tech Challenge earlier, and that is actually the main use case that the sensor was designed for. It can certainly be used in other applications, as demonstrated, but the FIRST Tech Challenge is really the main use case that it was designed and tested for. In case you're not familiar with the program, teams of middle and high school age students build robots like this and compete on a field like this. So we'll do the demo in a moment, but first we'll give an introduction and context for what we're showing off here. This is local FTC team 11260, Upper Creek Robotics.
Hi, I'm Sylvia.
I'm Nichelle.
And this is a team that's been around for 8 years. They're very well known and experienced in the FTC program, they're especially well known for their autonomous odometry and all their software. And they've been to world championships 4 times. So can you please tell us a little bit about the odometry solution on your robot?
Yes. So this is our competition robot that we built for this last season, and it uses dead wheel odometry for navigation. On the bottom of the robot, we have 2 spring-loaded Omni wheels that are mounted at 90 degrees to each other and point towards the center of the robot. The wheels use encoders so they can measure translations in either direction, and they are mounted so that they can spin freely without slipping on the ground.
We also use an IMU on the main control hub to measure our heading, and we perform all the math in our code to calculate the robot's position. We have been optimizing our odometry over the last 8 years to get the best performance we can, which is what led us to this solution.
So, highly optimized dead wheel odometry is going to be our point of comparison for the performance of the optical tracking odometry sensor. I actually showed up at the team's place last night and slapped one of the sensors on the robot. It is actually literally held on with tape at the moment. Although the optical sensor is rated for a mounting height of 10 to 27 millimeters, that is only true for shiny or glossy surfaces. For the darker foam tiles that are used by the FIRST Tech Challenge field, it really needs to be like exactly 10 millimeters. So after mounting it, we then spent a few hours getting all the demos ready for this. So in this first demo, we're going to manually drive the robot around the field and compare how the tracking performs from the dead wheel odometry versus the optical tracking odometry sensor. We'll start the robot in the center of the field, which is the origin, and then we'll drive it around and see how far off the coordinates are after we bring it back to the center. All odometry solutions like this will lose accuracy as the robot moves, The sensor itself has a rated accuracy of 3 to 5% for the optical sensor, although the firmware on the microcontroller has a calibration that can bring the accuracy within 1%. What that means, if you drive the robot around some closed path that returns to the starting location, the measured coordinates should be within 1% of the total path length. It's not guaranteed, but it's pretty typical based on our testing. Now we will manually position the robot back exactly at center. That's pretty good. So what are our coordinates at?
For the dead wheels, we're at negative 0.35 inches in X, 0.39 inches in Y, and 178.9 degrees for the heading. And then for the optical sensor, we're at negative 0.64 inches, 0.36 inches, and 179.5 degrees.
Wow, that's better than we normally get for the optical sensor. We estimate the total path length that we drove was around 500 inches or so, and both sensors in this test are off by about half an inch, so that corresponds to a percent error of around 0.1%. That's actually pretty typical for the dead wheel odometry based on our testing, although the optical sensor is usually more on the order of about half a percent. So that is how the tracking performance compares, and now we'll jump to our other demo showing the robot doing an autonomous routine with the optical tracking odometry sensor.
For this demo, we modified one of our old autonomous routes to run with the new optic sensor instead of our old dead wheel odometry. We didn't have too much time to test it or tune it, but so it'll be a little bit slower and shorter than normal, but it was pretty easy to swap them out and it runs basically the same how it did before. In this routine, the robot is preloaded with a couple game elements and quickly scores them, then drives to the other side of the field to pick up two more game elements, then drives all the way back and scores those as well.
Now, full disclosure, we did have to tweak some numbers in order to get this working, and it's not perfectly consistent, so it wasn't a complete drop-in replacement, but it was good enough for us to get this autonomous routine working. So hopefully that gives you a better idea about the performance and accuracy of the optical tracking odometry sensor. Obviously, it will never be perfect, but depending on your application, it can be more than good enough to track your robot to its destination. So thank you again to FTC Team 11260 Upgrade Robotics. Thank you, Nichelle and Sylvia.
Thank you for having us.
Now we'll give some advice on using the optical odometry sensor in order to get the best performance out of it. If you just take it straight out of the box and start playing around with it by hand, you'll get data, but do not expect it to be accurate. The sensor really needs to be mounted correctly, and there's some calibration you need to do in order to get the best, most accurate data. The boards actually ship with a piece of Kapton tape over the optical sensor, which is there to protect it during manufacturing and shipping, but you'll need to remove it since it will absorb some of the laser light. Once you do, try your best to keep the optical sensor clean and avoid touching it, since any gunk on the sensor could cause it to have degraded performance. Arguably, the most important thing you need to do is make sure the sensor is mounted correctly. It really needs to be flat and at a height that is optimal for the surface that you're tracking over. If you have a shiny or glossy surface, then you should be able to get the full range of 10 to 27 millimeters that the sensor is rated for. But if you have a dark or diffuse surface, you may need to be on the lower end of that range. If you have a very dark or very diffuse surface like carpet, for example, probably just not going to work. If you do need a mount, check out our hookup guide where we've linked to some 3D printable mount designs for different robot platforms, or you can even design and print your own. The IMU on the board includes a 3-axis accelerometer and 3-axis gyroscope, which will likely have some offsets that should be calibrated out. This is especially important for the gyroscope, since any kind of offset in the rotation rate can cause the sensor to think the robot is constantly spinning. If you're using one of the provided software libraries, the IMU calibration can be done with the function called calibrate IMU. It's important to note that the board must be completely flat and stationary during this time because it grabs several measurements from the IMU and uses that to calculate the offset from the data. The last bit of calibration can be a little more involved. The data from the odometry sensor can have minor scaling issues that should be calibrated out. It's especially important to calibrate the angular scaler because an error in the measured heading can cause the linear measurements to be rotated by the wrong angle. And that would cause all of your data to have more error. It is recommended to first set both of the scalers to 1, then calibrate the angular scaler, then calibrate the linear scaler. In order to calibrate the angular scaler, I recommend taking your robot and aligning the edge of the chassis with something straight, here I'm using this table, and then rotating the robot by some known amount and comparing with the measured angle. I personally like to rotate the robot 10 times counterclockwise being positive rotation, and then realigning it with that straight edge. Doing it several times helps to make the scaling error more obvious while minimizing any kind of error due to imperfect alignment. Also keep in mind that the angle wraps around from minus 180 to positive 180 degrees. So if after say 10 rotations you see an error of minus 15 degrees, for example, then the total measured angle would actually be 3,600, that's 10 rotations, minus 15 degrees is 3,585 degrees. In order to calculate the angular scalar, take the true angle we rotated through, that's 3,600, divide by the measured angle, 3,585, and that gets you your scalar of, in this case, 1.004. Calibrating the linear scalar is a fairly similar process. You need to move the robot some known distance and compare with the measured distance. I recommend doing this over a relatively long distance and do it multiple times at different speeds to, again, help minimize systematic errors, as well as the resolution of the optical sensor actually changes a little bit based on how fast it's moving, so that'll help get a good average. Then once you have your data, then take the true distance, divide that by the measured distance, that gets you your linear scalar. Every board will need different scaling values due to manufacturing differences, but it should be consistent per board, so you should only need to do the scalar calibration once per board. By default, the optical tracking odometry sensor will report the coordinates it measures for itself. However, if you instead want to get the location of your robot, you can inform it about the offset between it and the center of your robot, and it will then automatically calculate and report the coordinates of your robot instead of the sensor. This means you can pretty much mount the sensor anywhere you want under the robot. In my case, I have the sensor mounted about 2.3 inches in positive X and 4.55 inches in positive Y relative to the center of my robot, and it's at the same heading as the robot, so a 0 degree difference. And that is actually what I've put into my code, you can see here. Hopefully all that helps you get going with the optical tracking odometry sensor. Now, for those who want more details, we're gonna go over the specs and features of the major components on the board. The primary sensor on the board is the PAA5160E1-Q optical tracking sensor from PixArt Imaging. It contains a class 1 laser that operates at 850 nanometers, which is just outside of the visible spectrum. The chip also includes an IR bandpass filter coating, so it is not necessary to block ambient light for indoor applications. The sensor has a resolution of up to 20,000 dpi, or dots per inch, and processes at 20,000 frames per second. The rated tracking accuracy is 3-5%, and it can track up to 2.5 meters per second at a distance of 10 to 27 millimeters from the surface. However, do note that some of the specs, like the mounting height, can be degraded depending on the surface being tracked. The sensor is really designed for shiny and glossy surfaces, so you may see degraded performance on other surfaces. The other sensor on the board is the LSM6DSO 6-axis IMU from ST Microelectronics. It includes a 3-axis accelerometer with 16-bit resolution up to 16G of full-scale range, and a 3-axis gyroscope, also 16-bit resolution up to 2,000 degrees per second of full-scale range. It includes a number of other features as well, but those are not used in the optical tracking odometry sensor. The last major component on the board is the STM32C0 microcontroller from ST Microelectronics. It features a single-core 32-bit ARM Cortex M0 Plus CPU running at 48 MHz. It contains 32 kilobytes of flash memory in the package and 6 kilobytes of SRAM. It has 18 GPIO pins and uses an SPI interface for getting data from the sensors and provides an I2C interface for communication with a host processor. It uses an I2C address of hexadecimal 17, and there are multiple libraries available to configure and get data from the board, including Arduino, Python, and Java for FTC teams. The board is preloaded with firmware that takes data from both sensors and performs the tracking algorithm. The main loop runs at 2.4 millisecond intervals, and it uses a Kalman filter that does the sensor fusion between the optical sensor data and the accelerometer data. It also includes a calibrated lookup table for the optical sensor that can significantly improve its accuracy, from 3-5% down to less than 1%. That's not a guarantee, but in our testing on the First Tech Challenge field, less than 1% is very typical. The board is a standard quick layout. It is 1x1 inches, or 25.4 by 25.4 millimeters, and the PCB is 1.6 millimeters thick. There are 4 total mounting holes, one in each corner, with 0.8 inch spacing, and each hole has a diameter of 0.13 inches, which enables screws up to 440 or M3. The board also includes a pair of quick connectors for easy connection and daisy chaining, or you can even use the solder pads along the bottom edge. The board also requires an input voltage of 2.8 to 3.3 volts. So, that is the SparkFun Quick Optical Tracking Odometry Sensor. The idea for this actually originally came from when I was participating in First Tech Challenge myself. My team had talked about the idea of using like a computer mouse or something to track a robot, but it was never really a viable option. Then as I got back into volunteering, I had seen how much odometry has evolved over the years, and the idea came back to me, so I decided to pursue it. Although the board has been designed primarily for First Tech Challenge, it can absolutely be used in other robotics applications, so we're looking forward to seeing how you use it. As always, stay safe, be kind, and happy roboting. In first robotics, robotics, there can be, have issues. Errors. Yeah. This happens a lot with me. Causing all the data had to be more accurate. Yeah, it's definitely more accurate when you have error. Yep.